In the last video, I created a fluidizing bed for casting lost foam patterns. I had to recast the bosses, and in this video, I'm going to go ahead and clean up the bosses and finish off the yoke. And by the end of this video, you'll get to see the shaper with the yoke connected to the ram and it reciprocating as it will when it's cutting material.
I cast two blanks that I am using to turn down the bosses. These bosses mount on the inside of the shaper column. This pin is the pivot for the yoke, and basically I'll turn down this other one, I'll mount it up, face off the sides, turn down the outside of this protrusion, drill it, bore it out, and that way these two will mount pretty much like this, and the yoke will be able to pivot on this shaft.
The process for cleaning up these castings is that I use the angle iron faceplate clamps that I made previously, and I clamp in the part. I then face off one side of that part, and after one side has been faced off, I flip it end for end, face off the other end, then I rotate it 90 degrees and put it back in the clamps, and face off then a third side. After the third side is flipped over, I then go on to face a fourth side. After four sides have been faced off, it's pretty much ready for drilling and boring. So I try to get it pretty well centered up in those faceplate clamps, and I had to kind of adjust my tool so that it could reach back up in right up next to the faceplate clamps. And this is just to turn down the diameter of that boss. Once I had the boss to diameter, I drilled out the bore of the boss, and then I marked how tall I wanted it to be. I used a regular cutting tool to score a little groove that I used to help me guide the hacksaw that I used. And I didn't cut all the way through the hacksaw. I cut it off without the lathe on, and then I cleaned it up just using a regular left-hand turning tool. Now, this would have been a really savvy place to actually bore this hole to 12 millimeters.
Oh, no!
Unfortunately, I didn't.
Gotta bore it. Ah.
I tried to line it up as well as I could just using that drill bit that I still had in the tailstock chuck, and that really didn't work that well. And I know you guys are probably just out there screaming, get a chuck, but I will make one eventually. At least that's the plan. This is the way the book calls for, so this is the way I'm doing it, using these faceplate clamps. And man, it really was quite a hassle to try to fight and find the center on that.
I really need to make a chuck. This, I got it to within about 10 thousandths plus or minus.
Fortunately, that really was all it took to get that hole sized to 12 millimeters and a pretty good fit for that shaft.
I was only able to face this surface on the part so far while it was in the chuck. But I mounted this one on the arbor, and what I'll do is use that to clean up the outside of this boss as well as this front face here. And that, hopefully this will make these two parts look, you know, look pretty cleaned up. The last thing I need to do is to clean up the ends of these yoke support bosses, and I'm going to do that pretty much on this 5-inch disc sander. Bob Teeter sent me this sander. He's one of my patrons. It really makes taking it out and putting it up a breeze compared to the 12-inch disc sander that I have. If you got a small shop, it's probably a pretty good fit. Bob really appreciates this sander. It's well-sized for my shop, especially in these temporary quarters.
After I had the bosses cleaned up, I went ahead and cleaned up the yoke bottom casting. And pretty much what I did is I put it on the arbor and just trimmed down the sides. This makes it a little easier to line up with the yoke arms. It'll be mounted to those arms later in the video, but having a little recess on either side helps ensure that the bore is perpendicular to the yoke arms. I cut the long arms of the yoke out of some 5/8 inch cold rolled steel, and I kind of sized it up and started drilling, match drilling the holes from the castings into those steel arms.
So now I get to drill this single hole out halfway through with a 6mm drill bit. That way the 6x1 fasteners can go all the way through. And then on just one side of the yoke, I'll use a 5.5. That way I can tap it to 6x1.
So I drilled and tapped one of the arms, and then I used that hole to bolt the upper casting to that arm. Then I C-clamped it, and after I had it C-clamped where I wanted it, I put it back in my drill press vise and drilled the hole. After I had that hole drilled where I needed it, I unclamped everything. And then I reclamped it with the other yoke arm. And that way I could drill a through hole. So now all three holes are lined up. And then I could take it out of the drill press vise and unclamp everything. At this point, you know, the type of work here becomes fairly repetitive where you're clamping and unclamping and reclamping and drilling and tapping. So I'll show you the process once through with the upper yoke, but then I'm going to skip it with the lower yoke casting.
It'll pretty much be the same drill on this last one. Clamp it up, drill it, change the drill, unclamp it, reclamp it, drill it, change the drill, unclamp it, reclamp it, change the drill, unclamp it, reclamp it, tap it, and then assemble it. So I'll do that off camera.
So the book describes a kind of iterative approach to positioning the yoke inside the column. And basically, what I ended up doing was clamping the boss on the left side of the column to the column side, and then kind of finally adjusting where that pivot point was located so that the clearance on the front would allow it to just barely clear that front casting, and the clearance on the back would prevent it from hitting the brace on the rear of the column. And it involves changing two things, the position of the pivot as well as the location on the bull wheel where the crank pin is located to drive the sliding block that rides inside of the yoke. So that did take a little bit of playing around to get it pretty well where I wanted it. I ground down some flats on the ends of the pivot rod, and that way set screws can clamp down on those flat faces. Then filed a flat spot on the bosses and gave it a little center punch so that I could drill a hole that I use for the set screws. I drilled it, tapped it, put a set screw in, kind of fairly normal drill here. It's important to always include flat faces onto rod stock so that when you have a set screw bearing down on it, it doesn't deform the rod and cause damage to the bore that that rod is riding in.
There's going to be an oil hole here going diagonally into the center of this bearing. I clamped these bosses into place. After a little bit of trial and error, I got it to where the yoke just barely doesn't touch this bracket in the back, and it just clears the front casting in the front, and there's just maybe an eighth of an inch gap up between the bottom of the ram slide and the top of the yoke. So I'm going to go ahead and mark the top of the slide block on the yoke. That's kind of the maximum travel, and I'm going to go ahead and drill holes and tap the bosses so that I can install fasteners and have these permanently fixed. And then we'll be on to connecting the top casting of the yoke to the bottom of the ram slide, so that way we can turn rotary motion into reciprocating linear motion. I repeated the same thing on this side. However, this particular bolt is going to interfere with the bearing support. So I'm just going to make a little mark here, and I'll get a file or something and make a little bit of a relief for installing this fastener. These are the parts that I'll need to complete the linkage from the ram to the yoke. And basically what it is there's two long bars that are then spaced apart using a rear spacer, front spacers. They'll be connected to the yoke using a linkage. And then there is a little ram clamp guide and the actual clamp that'll mount to the ram and secure all of this apparatus to the bottom side of the ram, and then the yoke can drive the ram with this articulating linkage. I went ahead and pre-drilled at least one hole in each axis. This back hole set is the first one that I really made acceptable for a fastener. I countersunk this one side and tapped the other side. So these holes will pretty much clamp this back part of this assembly, and that will allow me to register the front holes of this assembly with the additional parts, and then I can go back and clamp them and drill them to where they're all perfectly aligned. It's always a little hard to get these things set up, but you can see how I did it to drill it in my small drill press over here. I used my drill bit to align the holes that I had pre-drilled in three of the parts, and then I lined up the last part where I wanted just using the bench surface, and then I C-clamped it into place. I held the other end in my drill press vise, and then I drilled through this bottom member using that same 3 millimeter drill bit. And then I'll go through and enlarge these holes, drilling, tapping, and countersinking where necessary. Then this rear assembly will be completed. I've got all of these through holes drilled, countersunk, tapped, and several different sizes of holes. I've even rounded over the corners of these linkage parts, and basically what it is, I drilled them with a 6mm hole and then attached them, put bolts on either end, and ground off the radiuses there just to kind of clean them up a little bit. Other interesting things, I'm using a mix of fasteners. So I've got these old quarter 20 screws with the tapered heads, and that is so that I can use these in fastening this assembly together. That way, as they're riding inside the column, they won't bump into the sides that support the ram. Need to get a long enough bolt that part of the bolt is unthreaded, and that way it kind of doesn't chafe on the inside of these holes. It instead can just pivot freely. These bolts that I have are too long, so I pretty much just clamp them together and then I throw them in the vise and use the porta band to lop off the end.
I want a free fit for the clamp guide block, so I had to file it down a little bit to get it to fit in between the clamp rails.
There's not really enough clearance here to be able to put this linkage as an assembly to connect it to the top of the yoke, because you can't get that pin through the top. So it took me a little bit of messing with it, but eventually I just kind of figured out, oh, this assembly goes on separately after the yoke's in place. So if you build one of these, that, you know, reading the book, it's not entirely obvious that that's the way it goes together. I used a Sharpie to kind of scribe the lines, but it was pretty easy to see because of the smears from the grease that I used. So I needed to know where the pads were on the bottom of the ram. Then I positioned the clamp assembly midways between those edge pads. I used a diamond scribe to scribe little lines of where the inside of these rails are. Then I positioned the guide block in between them. I used a small drill bit to match drill the 3mm hole. Then I kind of center punched it, drilled it a little bit more, took it over to the drill press. I drilled and then I tapped this hole for a 6mm fastener. I kind of finished up the guide block. I drilled the hole and tapped it for the clamp, which has an 8mm fastener that will go on the top. I then also drilled a 6mm hole with a countersink for the fastener that will connect the guide block to the bottom of the ram. So now I'll assemble all this and put it back on the shaper, and that means I should be able to turn the bull wheel and see the reciprocating motion of the ram.
Special thanks to all you patrons out there. If you like the video, consider sharing it with somebody who you think may also like the video. And thanks for watching.